It's a pleasure and honor to give you a first lecture. So the topic is Generation 4 reactor design concept. So I will try to give you a brief introduction. It's not directly related to modeling and simulation. It's rather an attempt to give you the overall picture, very brief, about the future directions in a new generation of reactors. So I have 1 hour, and my lecture is a bit more was created for a bit more time, so I will have to be quite quick, and sometimes I will skip or go quickly through some slides, and I put here the link I found at YouTube, the video of my lecture from last year, and it was a little bit longer, like 1 hour, 40 minutes. So if you would like to hear some more details, you can go and listen to this lecture. So the plan is, after introduction, I would like simply present you six Generation 4 reactor designs and summarize, and hopefully have some time for questions and answers. If you talk about Generation 4, we should mention previous generations. So the first one started in 1950s. They are called early prototypes. Then we talk about generation two, when we mean large-scale power stations. And then generation three and three plus are evolutionary designs. And these are, I think, the majority of currently working reactors. So generation four group of designs is reactors of future, except probably few exceptions. Yeah, few examples which I will mention. I will mention during the presentation. First of all, I think in the introduction we should mention Generation 4 International Forum, which is a club created in order to establish R&D cooperation aimed at assessment of feasibility and performance of future reactors. So you see the list of countries. Russia joined in 2006. And you see in the table the list of six reactors with different neutron spectrum options. So again, you can see here the six designs in the form of illustrations. So a color code of the frame is red stands for fast neutron spectrum, blue for thermal, and the solid line is a reference option of neutron spectrum, and dashed line is sort of backup option. So you see here three fast spectrum systems: sodium, lead, and gas. Sodium, lead, and gas, and then molten salt reactor has a fast spectrum as a reference one and thermal as backup one. Then we have very high temperature reactor, which is definitely thermal. And finally, supercritical water-cooled reactor with thermal neutron spectrum as a reference option and fast spectrum as backup option. So Generation 4 International Forum established the goals for the, okay, I don't see chat for some reason, but yeah, you can answer the questions in the chat, and then I will try to answer at the end. So if you would like to interrupt me, then switch on your mic, because I don't see the chat. Okay, so Generation for International Forum, or GIF, established main goals for this future reactor. You can see them here. It's sustainability, which means fuel supply, long-term fuel supply, and minimization of waste. And here we immediately think about importance of fast spectrum and fuel breeding capabilities. The second goal is safety and reliability. And here we need very low likelihood and degree of co-damage and elimination as a challenging goal, elimination of the need for offsite emergency response. Goal three is economics, so the life cycle cost should have advantage over other energy sources, and financial risk should be comparable. And finally, goal four is proliferation resistance and physical protection. So in my lecture, I will talk mainly about the first three goals. So for presentation of six concept, reactor concept, I use a template, a matrix. So first I will present a general concept. I will show you a conceptual image and present main features. Then we'll give you a slide with a sort of fact sheet with advantages, challenges. I will mention designs and development and reactors under operation. And then for every reactor type, I selected specific example and will show you some main parameters for reactor fuel, core balance of plant, and problems from viewpoint of GIF goals. So before going to Gen 4 system, I start with pressurized water reactor, which is a basis of current, I would say, reactor fleet. So this is generation 3 or 3 plus concept. We will use to compare the new reactor designs as a reference point. Yeah. So this table shows the matrix which we will build this table for PWR first, and then we will have six more columns at the end. And we will try to use this matrix to see the overall picture. So here, specific design, which I will select the power efficiency, primary coolant and moderator, the pressure of primary coolant, the temperatures at core inlet outlet, neutron spectrum, breeding gain. I give always reference to some document where I took this this information. And then, as I mentioned, I will give you some estimate of three goals: sustainability, safety, and reliability, and economics. And in case of PWR, I would say sustainability is rather poor because of thermal spectrum and low breeding gain. So we are not able to produce enough fissile material from fertile, as in fast reactors. But safety and reliability and economics are definitely good or excellent in some cases because of the big experience. So this is a reminder about how fuel looks like. So the fuel is classically enriched uranium dioxide, cladding is zircaloy, which is zirconium-based alloy. So you see the fuel pellet, which is ceramic, 1 centimeter height, which are put in the cladding tube of about 3 meter high. And then these tubes with fuel inside, called fuel rod, they're assembled in an assembly in square geometry. Spacer grids are used to to position and to fix a few elements. And then absorber is inserted inside special channel in almost every assembly. And then all assembly are put together to form the core, which you see on the right. Advantages of PWR is, first of all, of course, operational experience and established technology, which has impact on economics. It's the coolant, which is light water, and this is well-known, transparent, easy to handle. We can apply boron control and so on. At the same time, we have challenges, which is high coolant pressure, and first of all, safety issue of depressurization, low breeding already mentioned. So designs under development, okay, there are a number. We can mention EPR. As of February this year, we have 302 operable reactor with this total power. Okay, so I repeat here the first column of our matrix. I highlighted here the efficiency and the economics, which is good. And I ask question, how to increase the efficiency even more to improve goal 3? And the answer is increase the water pressure and temperature. And we arrive at the first GIF system in our presentation, which is supercritical water-cooled reactor concept. So it operates at very high pressure above thermodynamic critical point of water, which you can see here on this diagram, pressure versus temperature at the bottom. So the temperature, operational temperature is 374, and pressure is as high as 22 megapascals. It applies advanced supercritical water technology used in coal plants and used direct one through steam cycle. So no steam generators, steam separators, and dryers. The advantages of this design is that it's based on Gen 3 plus reactor technology and merges it with advanced supercritical water technology used in coal plants. It has higher efficiency than Gen 3 plus, let's say PWR, and both thermal and fast spectrum possible. At the same time, the challenges are quite evident. We have a challenge with materials, water chemistry, and radiolysis, challenges with thermal hydraulics, because there are gaps in supercritical water heat transfer and critical flow databases. So we should demonstrate safety, in particular, the void effect for fast spectrum option is positive in this design, and fuel qualification. It's all connected with high temperature and corrosively aggressive medium and high pressure, of course. Design under development, ICE Electric is high performance light water reactor, which was developed in frame of Euratom projects. There is no reactors under operation. So here again, I put the second column, which is first gen 4 design, this high performance light water reactor. So you see thermal power, you see the increased efficiency compared to EPR primary coolant. So in terms of temperature, the coolant heating increasing from about 30 degrees in PWR to more than 200 degrees in this reactor. So the outlet temperature is 500 degrees. And this is the issue for peak cladding temperature with a target of 630 degrees. And this is the reason of complicated design considered for this reactor. In particular, heating in three steps, I will show you on the next slide. With red color code, I emphasize the problematic parameters, and breeding gain remains poor. so it doesn't change compared to PWR. Safety and reliability are evaluated as reduced, and we will talk about this, but economics is improved. So the design is complicated. I will go quickly, but it's at the same time interesting. So I mentioned the three steps of heating. So the idea is to have power reducing at each step and have intensive coolant mixing after each step. So you see here on the right, the vessel inlet, separation of water, like feed water flow by 50-50%. So 50% goes to down camera, low plenum, and then core inlet chamber, and it enters the evaporator, the first channel, or the first set of channels. Yeah, then it goes up, mixing in upper chamber, then it goes down through superheat one channels, again mixing, and then goes up to finally enter core outlet chamber and leave the vessel. So three steps, yeah, with careful mixing in between, which allows to improve, to reduce the peak cleaning temperature. Another feature is this 50% of feed water which goes up, and then it enters the channels in the center. So there is water boxes at the center with separate circulation, as you can see here. So it goes down, then it goes up through the inter-assembly gaps and goes down through reflector to enter core inlet chamber. And what these water boxes are used to improve moderation. Here you can see the reactor vessel and the internals. First of all, look at the wall thickness. It's 45 centimeters. It's impressive, right? 45 centimeters of stainless steel wall because of 22 megapascals inner pressure. Then the second point, that feed water is only feed water at inlet temperature is in contact with the vessel. So it's organized like this. You can see that feed water goes down and then enters evaporator, then mixing here, goes down through superheat one and goes up through superheat two, and then is leaving here at outlet. Some details of water channel I mentioned already, backflow limiter. I think I have to skip. The core design is formed by clusters of nine. So there are 52 clusters. And as I mentioned, there are three groups of channels. So the central blue is the first one. Then when we go to periphery, there is a second in red and a third in yellow. And therefore, it's naturally decreasing the power. And again, this is done to flatten the temperature non-uniformity and to minimize the cleaning temperature. This is balance of plant concept, complicated, but very well mastered with very good efficiency. And it was mastered not only in nuclear, but also in coal plants. So we put again together, we start forming this table. It's a repetition, again, with highlighting the problematic parameters. And the question is how to keep high efficiency, improve goal three, economics, but at the same time, avoid problems related to water at high pressure and temperature. So improve G2 safety and reliability, we see it decreased. And the answer is use inert gas instead of water. Okay, and we arrive at thermal concept, thermal neutron spectrum concept still, which is very high temperature reactor. Based on graphite reactor core, as you can see here, this power conversion system, which is in this case a heat exchanger, and then use of this reactor heat. In this case, it is emphasized that it can be a hydrogen production plant because we can have really high temperature of helium in this reactor. Both graphite prismatic and pebble bed are considered as reference configuration. And one of the main feature of this concept is very low power density. So what are the advantages? High temperature enables non-electric applications as hydrogen production, for example. It's very safe, you can say walk away safe. Even if you lose all coolant, the reactor will shut down itself and will cool itself by radiation and natural convection of atmospheric air. It uses inert gas coolant, so no issues with corrosion like in previous design, and it has high efficiency because of high temperature. The challenges is first reach temperature of 1000 degrees, for example, for hydrogen production, coupled with process heat applications, so we don't have much experience, operational experience on coupling reactor with heat applications, and utilize graphite as a waste is another challenge because of the big volume of the graphite. As design under development, I would mention Chinese HTRPM and reactor under operation, Japanese HTTR. So in this, as an example, I selected Chinese HTRPM. You can see here, okay, we call it VHTR. It relates to VHTR family. It has low thermal power, so it's like small to medium reactor. It has high efficiency. You see the coolant, you see inlet outlet temperature, you see the pressure, which is significantly lower than 25 megapascals of supercritical reactor. Moderator is graphite, spectrum is thermal, and therefore breeding gain is low and sustainability is questionable. In addition to low breeding gain, we also produce large amount of activated graphite, but we have very high safety and reliability and quite good economics. So this gives you the idea how this pebble bed operation looks like. The fuel element is fuel pebble, which is a graphite pebble of diameter of 6 centimeters. And inside, if you look inside, we will see a lot of small coated particles inside the pebble bed, sitting inside, like shown here. And every particle has diameter of less than millimeter. So there is a uranium dioxide kernel you can see here, which is about 400 micron diameter. And then there is several layers of different carbon buffers and layers listed here in order to guarantee the to create barrier to fission products, and in particular gaseous fission products. So number of pebbles in the core is like 400,000. You can see how they move through the core. They are permanently inserted and removed, and then they are recycled. So as you can see, fuel loading scheme is multi-pass. It's up to 6 times. You can see the idea about number of coated particles in each pebble and mass of heavy metal per pebble. Okay, so it's just 7 gram. Imagine you have 6 centimeter sphere and heavy metal inside is just 7 gram. So it's very diluted, very low power density. So this shows the balance of plant of HDRPM design. You see the pressure vessel here, reflector, fuel region, and connected to reactor part is conversion, power conversion system with steam generator. In this sense, it's quite classical configuration for high temperature reactor. Some details, some drawing to show that it's twin reactors. Power density is about 3 megawatt per cubic meter, and this is about factor of 30 lower than in PWR. So this gives this reactor very high thermal inertia, and this is one of the basis of very high walkaway safety. So there is no need in core emergency cooling system since decay heat is removed by natural mechanisms, as I mentioned before. So I repeat the table. I highlighted the problems, which is low breeding gain and problem with sustainability. The rest is quite good parameters. But the weakness of both supercritical and very high temperature reactors is low breeding gain and difficulty to reach goal one, sustainability. So how to reach this goal, and in particular, how to improve fuel utilization? And the answer is change the design to obtain the fast neutron spectrum and improve breeding. And we arrived to gas-cooled fast reactor. Which is a fast reactor, so there is no moderator. It's a sort of naked core, the fuel cladding, and then that's it. So we are missing now thermal inertia. It's still using helium coolant. In the development of this concept, it started with direct cycle, as shown here, but both direct and indirect cycle was considered over years. And at the current moment, indirect cycle selected, it means there is a heat exchanger and there is secondary helium system. So advantages is breeding and potential for new fissile generation due to fast neutron spectrum. The coolant is transparent and inert. And high efficiency due to high temperature. The challenges, first of all, is we should demonstrate safety, in particular decay, efficient decay heat removal in case of loss of flow and depressurization accidents. And we need high temperature materials and high pressure. And we have to qualify the fuel and demonstrate that fuel is operating. For designs under development, I would mention Allegro and gas-cooled fast reactor. So the small option and a big option, there is no reactors under operation. Again, I selected as an example for GFR gas-cooled fast reactor developed in European projects. It's big. Big power comparable to supercritical one, so high efficiency, helium, high temperature, well, although not 100, but as a reference design, 780, 7 megapascals pressure, no moderator, and therefore low thermal inertia. So for safe, for sustainability, I show the improvement and breeding gain close to zero, which means either breeding option, but safety and reliability is a problem, and economics is question marks because it's very strongly linked to necessity to guarantee safety and reliability. From you point of fuel. It's one of the challenges, and I show here one of the fuel concept developed in a European project by CEA. It's quite exotic. It's cylindrical, traditional form, but the fuel type is a carbide, so dense fuel. And the cladding is a sandwich. It's based on siksik material, but with a liner in the middle between two siksik layers. And this metallic liner should be based on high temperature metal like tungsten. And tungsten or other similar metals are very neutronically, very good neutronic absorber, which is not good. So it's important to carefully take it into account in neutronics optimization. But this this layer or this metallic liner was considered in order to avoid the diffusion of gaseous fission products and other fission products through siksik cladding, which is not hermetic because of, in particular, because of micro cracks. You know, siksik is a ceramic, it's a fragile material, so it's difficult to avoid. It's difficult to guarantee the containment of all fission products. And also because of the high swelling rate of dense fuel, CEA considered buffer bond between fuel and cladding in the form of high porosity carbon-based braid shown here. So the core is a quite classical two plutonium content zones and reflector. So from viewpoint of balance of plant or reactor design, again, we'll see configuration typical for high temperature gas reactor with a reactor vessel and power conversion loop with a steam generator, but also we had to introduce decay heat removal loops to address the issue of low thermal inertia and necessity to demonstrate safety in case of loss of pressure, depressurization events. So one of the measures is guard vessel to guarantee the backup pressure in case of depressurization. And balance of plant concept is summarized here. You see in the middle reactor vessel, and here one loop with heat exchanger. With the secondary working fluid is a mixture of helium and nitrogen at 65 bars. So there is a Brayton cycle concept and a steam generator. And guard vessel for backup pressure, I mentioned, shown here. And there is also quite unusual and traditional heavy gas injection reservoirs with heavy gas to inject in accidents with depressurization. So it's like emergency water injection system in a pressurized water reactor for the cases loss of coolant accidents. And in reference designs, there are DHR loops with forced convection shown here. So there are DHR blowers, there are DHR heat exchanger, and on the secondary side, there is a naturally circulated water with a big pool of water to reject decay heat. It's again pressurized system. So this creates a lot of engineering engineering concepts to reconfigure the circuit, because in normal operation this DHL loop should be closed, and accident operations, the main circulation loops should be closed and DHL loops should be open. So it's a lot of valves, a lot of logistics, and a lot of control system which potentially create the issues. A few ideas we considered in this European project on how to improve safety. I mentioned that DHR, decay heat removal under depressurized condition is a key safety issue. And I mentioned very low thermal inertia of coolant and no moderator. And one of the ideas that instead of coolant thermal inertia, use mechanical inertia. And for example, by indirect coupled cycle, so to put primary blower on the secondary turbo machine shaft, and then will give us a large thermal inertia and very low cost down curve for primary blower, to give us not so abrupt loss of flow accidents. Heavy gas injection, I already mentioned. But also we considered and simulated passive decay heat removal loop using Brayton cycle. So this is a DHR loop I already showed based on forced convection. And here you can see the Brayton cycle. So there is no active pump, and decay heat in a way is used to run turbine coupled to compressor and therefore to organize circulation. Interesting passive device, but again, there are issues with how to launch it, how to start this machine. Okay, so again, summary, I repeat the table with GFR column highlighting the problem, high pressure, no moderator, and issue with safety and reliability. And I repeat, the weakness of this design is low thermal inertia of the core, requiring special safety measures against core meltdown in case of depressurization events. And the question is how to improve. Second goal, which is safety and reliability. And the answer is, let's try using liquid metal instead of gas. So we arrive at sodium cooled fast reactor concept. This is the fourth reactor. So you see here a conceptual image. We rely in European designs on a pool type reactor, which is a big pool with filled with sodium, and all reactor internals are sitting inside this pool. There is an internal vessel to separate hot pool from cold pool. So pump is driving cold sodium in the core. It's heated up, enters primary, hot pool, and then through heat exchanger, hot pool is connected to cold pool. And the heat exchanger is sodium-sodium because there is an intermediate circuit. And then with secondary pump and the steam generator. So what are the advantages? Again, breeding, good sustainability, then excellent thermal conductivity of sodium with very efficient cooling for the tight lattice, which we need to have high breeding rate. Then sodium has large margin to boiling. There is no need for pressurization, which is significant improvement of safety compared to pressurized water concepts, and significant operational experience. So 300 plus reactor years, in many countries. The challenges, the first one is, of course, chemical activity of sodium in contact with water or air, and this is the reason why we need intermediate circuit, intermediate heat exchanger, to avoid potential contact of steam from steam generator with primary sodium, which could be radioactive, activated material. In case of steam generator tube rupture, then with intermediate circuits, the contact will be only with secondary sodium, which is not activated. And the second challenge, I would say, significant scattering cross-section of sodium 23, and therefore, when sodium is removed and we observed spectrum hardening, so fast reactor becomes faster, and therefore we have positive reactivity effect, because in a high energy region, the eta value, which is ratio of production to absorption rates, is positive. So we have positive reactivity effect, and we need special safety measures to find the countermeasures to compensate this positive effect with some negative effects. Design and development, I would mention PFBR in India, BN1200 in Russia, Astrid in France, which is, let's say, frozen, and ESFR in Europe. Reactors under operation, okay, we all can be proud that this is, first of all, Russia with three reactors, BOR-60, BN-600, and BN-800. I mentioned at the very beginning that we have generation for systems in operation, and I would say the closest reactor currently in operation to generation for goals is definitely BN-800. And we should mention also Chinese experimental fast reactor, which is under operation in China. Okay, as an example of sodium fast reactor, I selected European sodium fast reactor because I'm involved in the European project, which is now ongoing, is FastSMART, where we work on the design and safety assessment of this system, which is high power, 3600 megawatt thermal. High efficiency, a bit lower because of a bit low temperature compared to supercritical and gas system. So it uses sodium, which is an issue because of the exothermic sodium water and sodium air reaction. You see temperature level, you see pressure, which is practically atmospheric, just the gravitational head creates some pressure in the core. We have good breeding gain. So again, reference design is isobreeder and improved sustainability, improved of some aspects, but degradation of other aspects of safety and economics, well, question mark, but I think in average, sodium reactors are more expensive than pressurized water reactor just because of less mastered technologies. Oh, the idea of SFR fuel rod and fuel assembly in case of fast reactor, the reference fuel and cladding materials are mixed uranium and plutonium dioxides and stainless steel. Correspondingly, so we need tight lattice to reach breeding gain close to zero. For this reason, traditionally, in most fast reactor, you will see hexagonal lattice of rods fixed with helicoil wire spacers instead of grid spacers. It's closed assemblies without cross flows between assemblies, but with the inter-assembly flow, which creates additional challenge for modeling in particular. Then absorbers are inserted in the dedicated assemblies, Fuel stack height is about 1 meter with helium inside the fuel rod. And we need, because of high temperatures and high energy of neutrons, we have elevated fission gas release. And for this reason, the fission gas volume should be bigger compared to thermal system. And rule of thumb, then it's approximately the same as a fuel, fissile fuel height, like 1 meter. So this is our core of European sodium fast reactor, so which we designed. It's perfectly symmetric. We have 6 batches corresponding to 6 years of fuel cycle. It's mixed scheme. It means there is no reshuffling. Every year we remove fuel assemblies of one color and replace them by fresh. We designed empty channels, which are curium discharge tubes, and we equipped all control rods with passively activated Curie point locks. So here you can see axial layout of the core. We used MOX fuel with the same plutonium content, and we flattened the power distribution by using different height. You can see in inner zone, the orange fissile height is shorter, smaller than in outer zone. You see curium discharge channel, these empty spaces, which simplifies the relocation of curium of molten core from core region to core catcher. Yes, and we see also sodium plenum, which serves as a liquid axial reflector and allows us to have significant negative component of reactivity in case of sodium boiling, because we, during the boiling, it's efficiently disappear the sodium. This liquid reflector is disappearing because of the boiling, and then the fuel will directly see the shielding, which is absorber. And in this way, we can compensate significantly positive component, spectral component of void effect by this leakage component. We have 3 primary pumps shown here in blue and 6 intermediate loops with 6 steam generators each. We use 3 types of decay heat removal systems. You see the chimneys for DHRS-1. The overall primary system, okay, no, nothing special. It's very similar to the concept I showed you at the beginning. In-vessel fuel handling system with 2 rotating plugs to be able to reach every assembly during refueling. We decided to skip to remove the second safety vessel and replace it by the liner on the surface of the reactor pit with the use of the insulation. We designed a cooling system, 2 cooling systems in the reactor pit, shown here, based on oil and water, and we evaluate these systems for decay heat removal, in particular in case of severe accidents. Here you can see secondary system, so this is intermediate heat exchanger, secondary pump, and 6 steam generators. So in parallel, we have the loop which is working on the secondary sodium for decay heat. So here we have sodium air heat exchanger and chimney. And we consider also some passive pumps which operate, for example, in case of thermal pump, it operates passively using thermal electricity, both for secondary loop and for DHR loop. And we also considered decay heat removal from the surface of steam generators based on similar concept used in Phoenix reactor and demonstrated the efficiency of this cooling during Phoenix end-of-life tests. This is balance of plant concepts, just repeating, showing all DHR systems and main parameters. And this is, again, summary table with the last column for SFR, for European SFR. And again, I'm highlighting the problems, which is sodium and safety and economics. So SFR is the most mature concept among G-fast reactors. However, we can identify some weaknesses, which is the risk of sodium water and sodium air reaction and corresponding design complication, for example, intermediate loop. How to improve goal 2 and goal 3, keeping good sustainability parameters. And the answer is, try to use another liquid metal instead of sodium. And here we come to lead-cooled fast reactor. So we see it's a simple design without intermediate circuit, reactor core, so simple circulation up and down of the lead with steam generators here, or it can be heat exchanger if we use the gas. The issue we have here is corrosion and special measures we need for oxygen control, for materials protection. So advantages again, the breeding, high density of lead and very high thermal inertia. High therm, not as high as sodium, but still it's metal. So high thermal conductivity and expansion coefficient, very efficient heat removal at low velocities and high natural circulation level. So lead is not active with water and air, so no intermediate circuit and large margin to boiling, and therefore we don't need pressurization. Well, the same parameters are reasons of challenges, like high density means high level of erosion and seismic refueling issues. At high temperature, what I already mentioned, at high temperature structural materials such as iron or nickel are slowly dissolving in lead flow and we need protection. There is high void reactivity effect since the margin to boiling is huge. So like you see here, the value, and it's higher than cladding melting temperature. But still we can analyze initiating events, which results in a positive void effect like entry of gas in the core for some reason. And the challenge also, small margin to boiling, but small margin to freezing. And we need special safety measures to avoid freezing when it is not assumed. So there is a number of designs under development, including European designs, ELFR, Alfred, Russian design, again, started recently, real design, Brest OD300 and US S star concept. There is no reactors under operation and very small operational experience from nuclear submarines. As an example, I selected European design Alfred, which is European LFR demonstration project. You can see parameters here. So it's small reactor with 300 megawatt thermal power. It uses lead as at almost 500 degrees and it's corrosion, or better to say dissolution of structural materials. there is low pressure, high breeding gain, good sustainability, but there are problems, still problems compared to sodium with safety and reliability now because of different reasons. And still economics, I would say, questionable. Some details about fuel sub-assemblies, so we can see special designs with very long fuel assemblies with practically drive line, with ballast to avoid flowing up of the assemblies. Otherwise, the core has a very similar design to sodium hexagonal shape. Primary system of Alfred with some peculiarities like position of pumps on the hot leg. So you see here the mechanical pumps, yes, and the core here. Balance of plant, here we can only mention that decay heat removal system or decay heat removal condenser based on water condensation is located in the secondary system. And this is a summary again with lead fast reactor as the last column with the challenges, which is a heavy metal, first of all, and associated problems with erosion and corrosion, and safety and reliability and economics are questionable. Samsung is improved, but Samsung is deteriorated. In general, in all considered systems, the accidents with core meltdown has extremely low probability, but they are still possible. And the question is how to practically eliminate the core meltdown. Well, it's a good question because you always can answer this question, whatever it asks, how to practically eliminate something. It's the answer is to make it. So if you want to eliminate core meltdown, we should melt down the core. So the answer is, use the design with liquid fuel, with molten fuel. And here we arrived at the last concept, which is molten salt reactor. Here you can see the thermal concept, the graphite channel in the core with circulating fuel through the channels. Then there is a heat exchanger, the pump. So the fuel, liquid fuel is circulated here. There is a freeze plug as one of the safety protection measures. It's passively can be frozen. And the fuel will be drained in special place with effective decay heat removal and subcritical configurations. Liquid fuel allows us to make online chemical reprocessing. And the second concept, which now became a reference, is FAST, and I just showed it by replacing the graphite region with channels by simply empty space where fuel becomes critical. Otherwise, it's similar. So the advantages of molten salt reactor is breeding in fast option, large margin to boiling, no need for pressurization, strongly negative fuel salt density, void reactivity effect, and this is the only fast reactor concept which has inherently negative void effect. Because simply we just remove fuel during voiding. High efficiency due to high temperature, no structural material in the core, so minimization of radiation damage. possibility to add or remove fuel salt and simplified reprocessing, online probably reprocessing, continuous removal of insoluble fission products like gas bubbles we can separate and keep separately. So xenon, krypton can be removed from the core online. Of course, number of challenges, strong corrosiveness of molten salt fuel, lack of usual barriers like fuel matrix or fuel cladding. And therefore, we should develop a new safety approach. High fluence on vessel, part of fuel always outside the core in heat exchanger, and therefore we need larger fuel inventory and we reduce effectively the fraction of delayed neutrons. Low margin to freezing, low or unknown solubility of compounds formed during operation requiring a lot of R&D. So there is a number of designs under operation. I mentioned molten salt fast reactor is a European concept. Mozart is Russian and FHR is US concepts. There are no reactors under operation currently. So this gives you the idea of molten salt fast reactor core design on the left and the reactor design on the right. So here you see the open volume, which is the core with a shape optimized for fluid dynamics to avoid recirculation in particular. 16 external recirculation loops. And here you can see draining tank and the channel with a plug, melting plug. Again, a begin balance of plant concept with some temperatures for MSFR. Okay, in general, I would like to mention here that in case of MSR, we are at the very beginning of the R&D, and for this reason, MSR, it doesn't make sense to focus on very specific designs. In fact, at current moment, we're considering a wide spectrum of concepts. And here we try to make a tree to make categorization of existing ideas, existing concepts. Okay, we arrived at summary. So we briefly considered six specific reactor designs representing six concepts in order to discuss some advantages and challenges of these designs. The ranking was not our goal. And this is the table we arrived at with emphasis on main problems of different designs. As a bonus, I give you this plot, which shows density versus temperature for seven reactors, six plus PWR. So you can see dependence on density, of liquid density, and then sometimes you can see the phase change and gas density. Of vapor density, and also I showed with these bars the operating range. So there is surprisingly a lot of information hidden in this plot, but then I would need another hour to talk about this. So I just leave it as homework, just material to think over. To think about safety issues of different reactor concepts. So this is references, and thank you very much. I completed a little bit more than 1 hour, but I hope I can try to answer questions if you have any.